incentives. Let me tell you something about the Clean Water Act. I was Hudson River Keeper from 1983 to 2000. And I spent most of my time working on enforcement issues. I know a lot about enforcement. With citizen enforcement, I know a lot about enforcement. Clean Water Act is a very unique provision. Section 505 says, anybody who's violating this law can be prosecuted by a citizen if the person violating the law is not already being prosecuted by the state or federal government. A citizen can step into the shoes of the United States Attorney General and haul a polluter into federal court if that polluter is not already being prosecuted by the state or federal government. And we use that section of the law over and over again. What do you think is the single biggest reason for an industry to violate the law? What's the most obvious reason in the world? What's that?
Cost and profit,
right? Here's a very simple question. Why, after this law's been on the book for 38 years, why should it be cheaper to violate the law? Why should it be cheaper to violate the law? There's no good reason for that anymore. The innovations that have happened in other parts of the marketplace are just remarkable. Second, Company A, Company B, Company C. They all produce the same widget. They all have the same kind of factory. They all have a permit limitation of 5 parts per million for oil and grease. Company A discharges 5 parts per million. Bravo, they're complying with the law. Company B is discharging 6 parts per million. Well, nobody's going to go after them because it's what they call de minimis. That's Latin, D-E-M-I-N. De minimis violation. It's small, and they'll let it slide. So that company is okay. Company C decides, I'm going to discharge 0. I'm going to make the extra investment, and I'm going to discharge no oil and grease. What do you think Company C gets in return for having done that? They get nothing. They get 0. There's no incentives. There's no rewards. There's no inducements for them to innovate or for them to do better. There is no industry in the country that gets an incentive or gets a reward or any kind of inducement to either develop technology that helps others perform better or to perform better themselves. These are the three big things that are missing. Meanwhile, what's going on in the rest of the world? I'll tell you what's going on in the rest of the world. In Ho Chi Minh City, Vietnam, it's partly cloudy right now. It's 79 degrees Fahrenheit. It feels like 85 degrees Fahrenheit. The UV index is low. Humidity is 94%. The wind is from the east. It's 3 miles per hour. The barometer is 29.8 inches and rising. In Ho Chi Minh City, in Vietnam, right now. There is nobody who can tell you what's in the drinking water in your glass right now. I can tell you the weather anywhere in the world. It's a, the innovations that what I have in my hand here is more powerful than anything that went to the moon. What the marketplace has provided and produced in innovations in the last 30 years is remarkable. But it's all gone in one place. And why is it all gone? Where are the places where it's gone to? It's gone to the places in the market that make people profit and to, in many ways, improve people's lives. That connection has not been made in water because the Clean Water Act is antithetical to a marketplace that's going to produce innovation that we need. It's 59 degrees in Johannesburg, by the way. The humidity is 94%. So. So what do we need to do? Well, we need to change all this somehow. We need to change direction. We need to change values. We need to tap into what's best in our society. We need to tap into what's best in all of us. We need to retire old rivalries. We need to stop the name calling. Maybe not 100% of the time, but most of the time. We need to do away with this idea that some of us are good and the rest of us are bad. That if we're all smart enough to sit in this room and have this discussion and agree with each other, somehow we're a lot smarter than other people out there who disagree with us. Well, it just ain't so. It just ain't so. I speak all over the country. And you know who I speak to? I speak to mostly people who were born after the first Earth Day. I speak mostly to people who were raised on environmental issues, who learned about them in school. The students in here. Of the students in here, how many of you started hearing about the environment in elementary school? Is there anybody who didn't hear about it in elementary school? Who are the students in here? You did. One, two people. The rest of the students heard about environmental issues in elementary school. My daughter, who is 34 years old, didn't hear about environmental issues until high school. My son, who was 14, started hearing about them in pre-K. Nobody talked about them when I was in school. It's a different generation that's out there. I was with the vice president, one of the vice presidents of IBM. A fellow named John Kelly. He's in charge of every environmental laboratory in the world, every innovation laboratory in the world that IBM operates. And he pointed out to the parking lot, and he said, "You see what I see out there?" And I thought, well, you know, I'm going to get a lecture on impermeable parking lots and all these things I know about already. And I said, "Well, now what do you see?" And he said, "Kayak racks, canoe racks." I said, "Oh," and I start looking at it. He's right. I mean, they're all over the place on people's roofs and bicycle racks. He said, we have a new population of people working in this company unlike any we've ever had before. I said, "In what way?" He said, "They want us to make a difference."